एमएच मकवाना जी, आप आए। प्रोफेसर एमएच मकवाना जी,
प्रोफेसर पाठक साहब, फ्रेंड नील रतन, रिचा पायास, डिग्निटरीज ऑन द डायस, और हॉल में जो सारे हमारे मित्र हैं जो अलग अलग स्टेट से आए हुए हैं, सभी को हमारा गुड मॉर्निंग। हमारे पास वक्त की कमी है और ज़्यादा न कहते हुए, क्योंकि अगर हम बोलने चलेंगे तो कुछ ज़्यादा वक्त लग जाएगा, इससे अच्छा है कि हम थोड़ा सा पढ़ ले जो भी हम लिखे हैं और समय बचा ले। हमारा टॉपिक है दलित्स, सैनिटेशन एंड एम्पावरमेंट। द कास्ट एंड रिलीजन आर एसेंशियली रिलेटेड टू सैनिटेशन। इट इज इन द कास्ट सिस्टम अ पर्सन इज बॉर्न, ब्रॉट अप एंड डाइज। Caste also determines one's occupation and choice in marriage. Caste largely determines in modes of domestic and social life. The contribution of caste system in the problem of sanitation is valuable in the present society. Studies have shown that there are differences among castes regarding sanitation. For example, scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, most disadvantaged groups in India suffer from poor household sanitation and drainage. The caste system, we all know, as a student of sociology, we all know about the caste system. Still, I will say something. The caste system is a unique system of stratification found in India. It is not only the oldest system of social stratification in India, it is also complex, hierarchical, and interrelated system. It is also the basis of division of labor in society. The social, religious, political, and economic and cultural life of Indians is influenced by the caste system, and many persons desirous of knowing the caste system. Thought in modern society, class system is the type of stratification found all over the world. In Indian society, caste system exists with the class system. In spite of the effort of social reformers and the governments to remove inequality and the operation of force to such industrialization, urbanization, modernization, education, etc., the caste system still persists. However, the structure and function of caste have changed. Here I have given something about the origin of caste system and the four varnas, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudras, and all these things. I skip that thing. Much has been said about the security afforded by the caste system to each of the caste in it. According to Hutton, an individual's membership in a caste canalizes his choice in marriage, acts, his trade unions, his friendly or benefit society, his status club and his orphans. It takes place for him of health insurance and if need be provided for funeral. Mencher is one of the view that the security afforded by the caste is only to the men and the top or perhaps in the middle range. From the point of view of people at the bottom of the caste has functioned and continues to function as a very effective system of economic exploitation. Caste and occupation. not only each varna had its own occupation, each caste had its own occupation. These occupations were hereditary. With the hereditary occupation of caste, it became obligatory monopolize of families belonging to the particular caste. It is also not merely a right to perform such occupation, but it is the duties imposed by birth. Wiser analyzed by the judge money system to explain the mutual services rendered by different caste. Dumont concerned that this system was based on religious values rather than economic logic. Caste purity and pollution. The concept of purity and pollution are closely related to caste hierarchy. The higher the rank of a Hindu, the higher the level of purity and lower the rank, the more impure he is. Dumont holds the notion of purity and pollution interlinked with the caste system and untouchability. Purity restrictions are prevalent regarding marriage, drink, food, touch, and occupation. Purity is associated with ritual cleanliness, such as daily bathing in flowing water, dressing in properly laundered clothes of approved materials, eating only food appropriate for one's caste, referring from physical contact with people of lower rank, and avoiding involvement with virtually improved substance. The latter includes body wash, waste and extraction, most especially those of another adult person. Combat with the product of death or violence are typically polluting and threatening to ritual purity. As people are graded on the basis of purity and pollution, occupation are also graded. The occupation of the Brahmins, highest in the caste hierarchy, are pure, whereas the occupation of the untouchables, lowest in the hierarchy, are impure occupations, like handling of leather or dead cow, the removal of human waste, and work on the cremation ground, sweeping the street, etc., are considered as lowest and impure. Untouchability and sanitation. Though the caste system is more than 2,000 years old, untouchability is of later origin. Till about the 2nd century AD, certain castes were despised, but not were considered to untouchables. The notion of purity and pollution, as Dumont observed, is internally linked with the practice of untouchability. Gradually, the notion of purity and pollution freed itself from its specific and original task of separating untouchables from the other, but began to be operative at different plans of the caste systems. Dalits and subcaste among the untouchables were involved in occupation which were usually considered to be polluting or defiles. Shearing, herding is defiling because swine defiles, leather defiles, and consequently, the making and repairing of shoes become an occupation of the untouchables. Occupation like scavenging, removing carcasses from the village, etc., become the occupation of the untouchables. Though they were related from the other caste, though the jajmani relation, they themselves were not eligible to receive several services by the upper caste services specialist. With the development of towns and cities, there arose the need for scavenging. As other people were not ready to do these jobs, municipality had to bring untouchables from the rural area in many towns and cities. They are housed in colonies and work as sweepers, cleaners, and sewage lines and sweepers of railways. Dalits and manual scavenging. Yesterday, our Professor Pathak and many others
Our dignitaries have said so many things about the manual scavenging. So here I am not going to repeat all that thing. But though we have progressed, still there are towns and cities where scavenging is done manually. It is essentially that every day 13 lakh people in India, of which more than 18% are Dalit women, are forced to human excrement with their hands, a practice called manual scavenging, for a little to no wages. The biggest violator for the employment of manual scavenging and construction of dry latrines, Prohibition Act of 1993, is the Indian Railways, which has toilets dropping all the extra from drains on the tracks, and they employ scavengers to clean it manually. Access to sanitation is in a complete denial for these people, as they have to do this manual job with their bare hands, and they have higher risk of occupational health hazards. Dalits and empowerment. This is, I have quoted from Professor Bindeshwar Pathak writing. Bindeshwar Pathak went to live in a colony of scavenger in Battalia, an outlying district of Bihar in India. There he had to experience of unclean occupation, and he observed condition and behavior of suppressed. This experience make him to thought about methods which may end scavenging. He realized that this was possible, and solution lay in replacement of the bucket toilet system. This led him devise and implement the two pit power flush compost toilet system technology for individual household and operating and maintaining public toilet linked with biogas plants attached to Sulabh effluent treatment. Device leading to liberation of scavengers from that demanding profession. Finally, he said, I am proud to say that it has been possible to do so and thereby bring about social transformation. So he is the person after Gandhiji who has tried a lot to bring social transformation in India particularly. So many persons and government particularly has done hard work and implemented so many schemes and government resolution and everything. But they were unable to achieve the goal as Professor Pathak has achieved. And it is our day-to-day experience now in every cities and even villages also we found Sulabh Sauchalaya, and the improved condition of scavengers, those who were in this with the occupation since centuries, now they have liberated from that. From my side particularly, and from this my university, I must thanks Professor Pathak for his valuable contribution to this country. In the 21st century, Dalit assertion in the social, economic, and political sphere is of paramount importance, and it can no longer be ignored. Social and political awakening have made Dalits more assertive and demanding, and it is a good augury for their development. The untouchables can no more be silent, and with education among them, they have become conscious and vocal about their poverty and low situation as well. With the passage of time, the mental horizon of the untouchables also widened. Some of their men came to government services and now are occupying responsible position in the administration also. This was bound to a healthy psychological impact upon Dalits everywhere in India, and it gave them a feeling of respectability. Gradually, it is percolated to the lower levels, with the result that the men at the lowest rung of the social ladder also become conscious and awakened, and he came into his own to acquire a new personality. He begins to assert himself and revolted against the old, was no longer prepared to tolerate the discriminatory and a human behavior of the upper caste. Hence the conflict and confrontation. For redressal of their grievance, the untouchables went to courts to seek the protection of laws. They have become bold and assertive. They demand a due share and participation in the social, economic, and political life of the state. This we can observe from the so many incidents taken place in Gujarat particularly, and Una incidents, and many other places where came out all over India, and people have registered for their behavior and all these things. With this, I sum up my thing. Thank you very much to the organizer, and particularly to the Sulabh International Services to give me chance to say a few words before you. And thank you very much for that you have listened me especially. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Professor Makwana.